us direction from above. We need a word.
Well, amen.
From the
Lord.
Amen.
It's good to see you.
Word.
Praise the Lord for the privilege to
just one
be here today.
From the Lord.
And
we'll move all the doubt.
And
cause the sun to shine and give us peace.
I'm crappy, but I'll So I guess I'll have to make a return trip when the weather's better.
Amen.
But on a serious note, it's really good to be here. It's really good to be here. And the truth of the matter, in spite of those wonderful words of introduction, I should have been crucified. I should have suffered and died. I should have hung on a cross in disgrace, but Jesus, God's Son, He took my place. Let us pray. Father, we thank you and praise you for your goodness. Thank you for your love and care.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you for the gift of the Lord Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
And we look to you now with our hearts and minds open, and we claim a blessing from the study of your word.
Yes.
And I pray, God, you stand in my body and think with my mind and speak with my mouth. Whatever you want to say to us, I'm available to you, and I thank you for all you're going to say and all you're going to do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Well, amen. I had the privilege, as you've already mentioned, to serve along with your pastor for some years at the Concord Church. Got to know him. He was the singles pastor. And I was telling them a little while ago, they still miss him at Concord. They still talk about him because he endeared himself there in such a marvelous way. And Pastor Bailey and I used to talk about him, and he said, well, he's my son. I said, well, then he's my grandson. But we all had very fond memories of you, brother, and all the work you did there. And I'm very appreciative to you and knowing you as a man of God. I really praise God for you. And look forward to your big day on tomorrow. Okay. I was thinking about what I would share with you guys this morning, and I had two or three things running through my mind, but y'all have eaten a big breakfast and I don't want to put you to sleep. So I'm gonna use one of my shorter texts. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 24, there's a neat little verse there, and it just says, faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it.
Amen.
The argument is, let God do it.
Right.
If God is faithful, God is calling, and he's prepared to do in you and through you what he demands of you, then we need to let him do it.
Yeah, come on.
Yeah. Being a man of God is not something you struggle to accomplish.
All right, all right.
It's something you let God do.
All right, all right.
And the reason you shouldn't struggle to do it is because you'll never be able to do it anyway.
All right.
Yeah. You were not designed to do it on your own. Only God can make a man. A man can't make a man.
All right.
Only God can do that. So Paul puts in this little verse these three thoughts. Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. The first thought in this verse is the presence of God. The presence of God. Mm. Faithful is He. Mm. Faithful is He. The presence of God. He is an ever-present God.
All right.
That's the great thing about our God. He's not somebody that's here today and gone tomorrow. Well, he's not somebody you got to look up every morning, but He is an ever-present God.
Yeah.
Yes, yes.
He's present even when you wish He was not.
All right.
He's an ever-present God. He's an ever-present God. He's an ever-present God, and when you got saved, He moved into you. He dwells in you.
Yes.
And He don't just reside here in your blood pump, but He resides in the sum totality of your being.
All right.
In every member of your body, God resides. Mm-hmm. If you're a Christian.
Yes, that's right.
If you're a Christian. He resides in every member of your body. That has some serious implications. If God resides in every member of my body, then if I was to take my hand and slap my wife,
well,
I force Him to participate because He resides in every member of my body.
All right, all right.
Including my hand. If I take my tongue and lash out at my child, I'll tear your head off. You straighten up, I'll pull your arm off and beat you with the bloody. He lives in my tongue. And I force Him to participate. I force Him to participate. He's an ever-present God. Yeah. He's an ever-present God. The Matthew says He's an ever-present God. He says, I am with you always. Even to the end of the age.
Yes, yes, yes.
How long is always?
Always.
And then the Hebrew says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. How long is never? He is an ever-present God. There's a song, Never Alone, No, Never Alone. He promised never to leave me.
Never alone.
Never to leave me alone. Just when I need Him, Jesus is near just when I falter and just when I fear. Ready to help me and ready to cheer just when I need Him most. He's an ever-present God. He's an ever-present God. There's no need for anybody to spend restless nights worrying and sweating about tomorrow. God is our shepherd, and we shall not want.
All right.
Yes, yes.
And this God who is our shepherd is an ever-present God. Yes. There is no need then for both of us to stay up.
Another calm on the sea. But what we need is a special word that will burn.